Taste my game fix.
Hello and welcome to, I'm not sure what episode of Taste My Game Face, I haven't checked
today.
Oh, you're right, it's right here. 43, we're on episode 43. So yeah, welcome ladies and gents. This is now 2017, this is the year that the world ends. I am your host, this is Yadi Emo, joined by
Joe Knight,
Alan Heath.
And Wayne James.
And we're doing that thing where we sign off at the start again.
Yep, we're doing that. Yeah. We should do that in future. Okay. Fine. Are we done? And that's a wrap. I'm going to go drink myself into oblivion.
Solid plan. Okay, so, ladies and gents, I haven't played any new video games since our last recording. I've just been playing the same ones over and over again.
I'm still playing Rocket League, so it's not a problem.
Titanfall XCOM, but I hear there have been things happening in the world of video games that are worth talking about, and I hear some of you have played some of those new games that have come out. So, would anybody like to share what they've been playing?
I'll start with a game that we kind of missed out on last year. I've played Dishonored 2, and it's really good. Didn't get the coverage that it probably should have, due to the fact that it came out against all of the big titles last year, but it was a bit of an unsung critical darling.
So before, sorry, because I want you to have the monologue on it, so I want to pick up on that point that you was making there about the fact that it had a hell of a lot to fight against, and the fact that I haven't played virtually any of the good games that came out at the end of 2016 because almost all of them were good. And I think that's saying that we should, like, I don't know what that means for games, and I just wanted to sort of throw that into the room. Is that a good thing or a bad thing that there were so many games that, like, people that love them can't play them anymore?
We kind of hashed this out a little bit at the end of the last podcast, talking about the fact that there were so many good games that it meant it was a really good year for video games, but it means that it might mean that in the future, instead of every publisher trying to produce an excellent game, that instead we just kind of pare down to those few titles that do sell really well. And that's kind of a terrifying prospect. But hopefully we can keep rolling forward and having more excellent. It might just end up being that we end up getting, like, the kind of hidden gems end up being indie games again, which is what they were until last year.
And with Dishonored 2, one of the nice things about it is it's published by Bethesda, and Bethesda have always got their open world RPG cash cows just rolling away in the background, which means that they can have a dalliance with a game like Dishonored 2.
I mean, Bethesda are a better publisher than most, in a lot of ways. They're willing to allow developers to make just single player games.
Yeah, solely focused single player experiences.
Which is something that a lot of us want, and it's weird that the rest of the gaming industry doesn't realise that.
But yeah, so Dishonored 2. Dishonored 2 picks up 15 years after the original. We've talked about the original a bit on the podcast, so go back and see our opinions on that. But it's about a supernatural assassin that's picking apart a conspiracy against them. It picks up with the main character of the original game, Corvo, looking after his now grown daughter, Emily, who is the Empress of Dunwall, which is the main city that they all exist in. And there's been a coup, and Corvo, when you get to choose who you play as. In my game, I picked to play as Emily, and Corvo has been encased in stone, and I have to do a revenge quest to see how I can right the situation
and take back
my throne. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's on the surface quite similar to the original, but actually there's been like a lot of subtle changes in scope of the level design and the way the powers work and interact with each other. It feels like there's so many more options. So as you go through the levels, picking off these different targets, there's always lots of ways that you can approach them, lethal, non-lethal. But the way that it expands on that now is by making the levels incredibly more vertical, incredibly more like different places to go, a much better interactive kind of ecosystem with the gods and the creatures that live there. Izzy, you've also played a bit of Dishonored 2.
Yes. So I've played the first, I mean, the third level roundabout. And like each one of them is this kind of like little open world of its own design that has a very kind of well-imagined, distinct feeling in its particular setting. And I got to say, yeah, that sense of verticality and scope that wasn't so much there in the first one, like, is, I don't know, it, I think in open world games, like, when a developer's trying to create a world that feels like detailed and cramped, if you want to create what feels like the kind of semi-fantasy idea of a city, like trying to create that hustle and bustle, the claustrophobia of it, like there's no better way to do that than adding some verticality into your world and kind of showing those layers of your environments that intersect with each other. And I think Deus Ex is really, really good at that. And I think that, well, because some of the level designers from Deus Ex, like the original, are people that now work for, I've forgotten the name of the studio.
Arcane,
the people that make Dishonored, that has come across. And I think they've been able to do that a lot more with the second one than they did with the first. I think they're kind of steps forward in how to design their levels really shone.
Sorry, can I just ask, and this might sound like a silly or meaningless question, but it, like, someone like me, actually, it kind of means something, because when you talk about levels, are we talking about regions in a broader aspect, or are we talking about how Doom played it, that literally you start here, you go here, you get a score or whatever? And
it's much more like kind of a mini sandbox. So there'll be like, you have objectives to fill within this sandbox. You have multiple ways that you can go about doing it, and you're pretty free to explore, but it's always funneling you to either progress to the next area or to assassinate your target and get out. Well, assassinate, you can deal with them in multiple ways, but deal with the target and then get out. So you're always kind of being pushed forward, but there's all these distractions on the side. So imagine you're walking through a market. You might overhear someone say that they need you to find a dead body. It happens that the church or the overseers, who are kind of religious zealots, have got this dead body that someone needs. So you have to break into their base, deal with a whole bunch of stuff in there if you want to see that optional content play out.
And you do.
Because all of it is good. Yeah,
exactly.
And does it all, I mean, does it interleave, or does it broaden the world, or does it sort of interleave with, does it enrich the main experience?
I feel it does both. Yeah, I think it very much, the thing that Arcane have always done is, I think, being honest with Dishonored 2, I think Dishonored 2's story is a bit weaker than the first, even though it fantastically bleeds in elements from the first game's downloadable content. So the story that happened there with the other assassin Dowd is incredibly important to the setup of Dishonored 2, which is great because that actually means something. Their DLC means something to them, and it's almost the prequel to this game. And the way that they kind of bring that stuff together is really interesting, but sometimes the way they tell the story and the writing like sometimes kind of dips, but their world building is exceptional. I think the core story is less interesting and less fun than the first one. The characters that you're doing missions for, I don't feel are as engaging, and I feel that it's kind of, Dishonored 1 did a lot of twists. And you kind of see them come in now. You can kind of see the strings, especially if you play through Dishonored multiple times like I have. But the world building is probably even better this time around.
Yeah, I mean, they go out, well, in the first game, you've got, it all takes place within that one city. Like, it's all within Dunwall, which is this kind of like Habsburgian, like turn of the century. Everything is powered by whale oil, but there's this like underlying element of arcane mystery and magic that's held together still through that same lens of the that industrialized world. Okay, but it's all there in that city. But what you do get are these books that are telling you about the rest of the world, that lore building stuff that we always see in gamers that are invested in lore building. This game, you get to go and see a lot of that world. Like, it's Dunwall is the center of an empire, and you are on the hunt to take back your empire. You need to go to different parts of it to find out about a grand conspiracy. So you're off, like, down in the south of your empire, like, in the second level, and that means that the climate is different, the architecture is different, like the pestilence that ravages like this particular part of the world is different.
So it's all a little bit more tactile this time around, is it? A little bit more, yeah, like genuine, you feel part of it, I guess, rather than, so it feels like something that's happening rather than just a platform on which to do your shit.
Yeah, except it didn't feel like just a platform to have a shit in the first one. But it does, I think this has happened to me personally, like, more and more throughout kind of this generation, near the end of the last generation of video games, where I thought that the design of a game was offering me all of the things that it could, and then the developers have worked out a way to breathe more life into it. And this feels like an example of that. This feels like it was providing me with an experience that I thought was incredibly, like, what's the word I'm looking for? Help me out here.
Authentic,
immersive, one of those, I don't know. Yeah.
Visceral.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Yeah, well, I was desperately reaching for not a buzzword. But anyway, all of them on the table. And yeah, like, this game manages to, I suppose, make them stop feeling like buzzwords and actually make it like feel like a genuine thing.
But there are, I think it's got some other real strengths, and one of its big strengths is it's so well crafted. So, for example, there's a section early on, in after kind of the first tutorial of how to engage with enemies in an environment, where you go down a kind of ascending set of rooftops, each one slightly further. And it's teaching you, without telling you, how far you can drop without hurting yourself. On the second level, you've got these items to explore for called bone charms. And you pull out, you've got a heart that when you pull out, it's an item that takes away one of your hands. It kind of, it shows you where the bone charms are in the level. First bone charm's pretty close. You wander down there, you pick it up. You look for where the next one is. You walk down a set of stairs and it's led you to the black market, which is where you buy your upgrades and how you kind of engage with kind of economics. And then you can kind of start to deal with that. But the way that it has designed that is so elegant that you look like, I was playing it and like having one of those kind of like, this is genius. This is like that, you know, screen one Mario. And they're just doing it all the time, like in the game, like everything is crafted so perfectly to tell you exactly, give you exactly the information that you need without stopping the game and saying, hey, here's a tutorial. This is how this works. And it's perfect. And it makes you feel free to experiment.
And the beautiful thing about it is that when you've got those like clever bits of design going on, if you already know how to work your way through those levels, if you already know all those things about how the world works, you can avoid, you don't have to go down that route. So I think it essentially means that for a second playthrough, which this game really wants you to do, once you've got all of that knowledge, you're going to be able to get more out of those levels from the get-go. But you can get quite a lot the first time through anyway. Like, once you've got those bits of knowledge built up, then you can kind of backtrack around and make sure that you find all the things you might have missed anyhow. But yeah, no, it's really very clever. Actually, there is a thing that I wanted to mention as well, which is talking about that heart that you need to use to find bone charms. The fact that it has the voice of your dead mother inside it that whispers horrible nothings to you about the world.
And it is her heart.
It's actually her heart. It's so good. And I think we haven't talked about that really yet. Like the feel of the world that is so much of what Dishonored is. I mean, it was so well refined in the first one. They feel like they've taken some good steps towards making it clearer and stranger all over again.
Yeah, I mean, they've done some really interesting things with how, I mean, without changing the look and feel of the game very much, where they've really expanded is within the scope of what they can do with the levels. I mean, it has fun with it. Levels have gimmicks now, much like how we were talking about the Titanfall campaign. Mm-hmm. Like, levels often have a thing that's happening within them that changes the gameplay, which keeps everything fresh all the time. One of them is set inside a clockwork mansion where the rooms move around and spin.
So I haven't got this far. I haven't experienced any of this yet. This sounds good.
Yeah,
this sounds
really good. And it's a marvel of architecture because there's lots of permutations of where the rooms can be, and you can get behind it, much like in a kind of portal Aperture Science Lab, where you can get behind into the mechanics of it, and you can kind of break your way out of the trap of the Clockwork Mansion by running super fast and blinking for a gap at exactly the right moment, and then you're behind it. And so, it's amazing, and it takes into account that you can do that, and it's fantastic level design.
Okay, so I just want to say, like, when you talk about like that idea of getting behind the curtain, it's that you can get behind the curtain, not that you must, not that, because it's reminding me of that bit in Uncharted 4, right, where you've got that sort of tower that you're climbing up, etc., and it's all gears and stuff, and that's the gimmick for a little while, but it stops when it stops. You're saying you can actually lift yourself out of the gimmick.
Yeah, well, there is encouragement to do that in some ways. You can kind of try and solve the puzzle by moving it around. But there was a character that said to me instantly, I turned up in this mansion, walked through, and the character said, ha ha ha, you're inside my trap, my Clockwork Mansion. All right, change the mansion. And he pressed the button. Everything started to move. I turned round, saw that there was a wall coming down. I blinked through that. And then in the first room, I was behind the curtain. I'd already done that. I could have been trapped in that room, and I would have had to have had a fight. But I was like, no, not today, mate.
I'm not playing the game the way you want me to play it.
Yeah, and then the game was like, this is chill. Look at all this weird stuff that you can see now that you're like behind the curtain. And I could ascend and descend the levels much easier because I was just working my way between the pistons and the struts rather than actually having to change the rooms in the way that the puzzle was intended. And the character remarks on the fact over a tannoy that I've done that, you know, and that's really clever. It's really good. It's like, oh, I see rats outside the maze. And I'm like, yeah, I'm coming for you. I stab you in the face like I do everything. Actually, that's an interesting point, because in Dishonored you can play it lethally and non-lethally. I quite like non-lethal or calculated lethal playthroughs of video games, but Dishonored really brings out my violent streak because the combat is so brilliant in the game. It's so ridiculously in your face and ridiculously violent that I don't know. And the stories are so based on revenge and control or the loss of it, and that I just find my bloodlust lays pulled straight out. I was playing as Emily, who I think a lot of people see quite a lot as a maybe a character that would be good for a non-lethal playthrough, because lots of her new abilities, because you have abilities in the game that you can kind of expand on over a tech tree that give you certain bonuses and certain perks in the combat, like that, quite a lot of hers are framed around stealth and control, because interestingly she's like the Empress of Dunwall. And so the powers that she has are all about controlling large groups of people or linking them together via a common community on a spiritual plane, which I think is really, like, when someone sat down and decided to think about what powers they should give Emily and they just went to her character sheet and said, she is this, let's make her powers that. That's just the level that video games don't really go to. And she's got some exceptional new powers, Domino being my favourite, where you can link the fates of different characters together. So you link four NPCs together, and if something happens to one of them, it happens to all of them. So I snuck into a base where there was a man doing summary executions. I linked him with the man that he was going to shoot, watched him blow his own brain out and the guy, and all of his mates were standing there going like, what? He shot that man and now his head is what?
wait, hold on. So I still haven't got Domino yet. When you say it links their fates, you mean if something happens to one of them, it happens to the other. So if you remove the limb of one of them, the same limb comes off of the other?
Yeah, they all die.
Okay. Exactly the same one.
Yeah. Like if you like, but it's beautiful. If you like link
one of the talking about bloodlust, removing the limbs is beautiful.
I mean, it's beautiful, and the way that it bleeds together and the kineticism of the combat is excellent. I had like a villa of people that got up in arms about me being there, and I was being chased around, and I thought, you know what, I'm gonna fight them. I was fighting 30 guards in this massive like banquet hall with this massive table in the middle of it. I'm running around, I'm cutting off heads, I'm like, guards are lunging at me, I'm throwing sticky grenades to them, diving over tables. Everything kind of like, nothing's nailed down in Dishonored as well. So as I dive over a table where there's a guy with a grenade stuck to him behind me, it explodes behind me and I see like the plates go flying past my head faster than I'm going. And I'm like, as I run towards the exit, I've got four guys on me, I've got one bullet, I spin round on the spot, domino all four of them, shoot one in the face, watch all four of them collapse on the floor, and you just go, I am death. This is brilliant.
Indeed. So I think like describing the thing that happened there, like the fact that they managed to make a game where you can be that force of destruction that you feel like so capable as like the master of all of these ridiculous spells and just completely badass with a sword in first person, and that at the same time as having this going on in the game, you could also be trying to stealth through without anybody ever seeing you, and they've made mechanics that make that incredibly satisfying as well. Like, to have that balance of things that you can do in a game and both of them be completely viable, I don't think any other studio does it.
So, did they, I mean, given that, like, I mean, this sounds like that something, you know, that would be incredibly enjoyable, that sort of careless abandon where you go and rip the heads off of enemies and shoot four people with a single bullet because you've linked them all together. I would need a really, really strong pull to not kill any of them. Like, is there a reward? Is there a... Yeah,
there are rewards. One of the really interesting mechanics is I played the high chaos playthrough, which is the violent route. But to achieve a clean hands playthrough, there are certain very creative ways that you have to, like, approach the targets, because you now can't kill a target. If you want to do a non-lethal playthrough, you can't kill a target, but there are certain throughout the level certain domino rallies that you can start to knock as you approach them that lead to a scenario being created that removes them from the board. You know, like, you can end up putting them into a situation where either you've converted them to your side, or you've convinced other people that they need to be incarcerated and things like that. And those are much more, I think they're much more rewarding story-wise. Yeah. They don't make sense to the playthrough I was doing.
So yeah. I have this hard time playing Dishonored because I always want to see those things happen, but also... What? Those bitches have to die.
Yeah.
So
yeah, fuckers got paid.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly how I
So could you could you go roll. Can you go through it like can you go through it stealthily and then just like circle back and kill them all anyway?
You could. Like, why
you have a high chaos playthrough. Then there
that suggests like the sort of trophy led playing, you know what I mean, where you sort of are going for this style of grade at the end. I'm talking about more intrinsically part of the game when I'm talking about reward system.
So the way I play is I end up with high chaos, but I'm not aiming for high chaos because I sneak through and I kill the people that have it coming.
That sounds to be everyone, by the way, that you've described the game.
Well, this is why it ends up being high chaos.
But also it's not, because the chaos system in Dishonored 1 was built around the fact that there was a percentage of the NPCs that you could kill. So 20% Under 20%, you're on a low chaos playthrough. Over 20%, you're in a high chaos playthrough. In Dishonored 2, every character and NPC is assigned an alignment. And that alignment means that they're either good-natured people or they're bad people. And if you solely kill bad people, you don't affect the chaos rating. And you can check that by using the heart to see inside them.
I did not know this at all.
Yeah, and Emily will tell you a bit of story. But no, it's not Emily, is it? It's
the old Empress. I can't remember.
Jessamine. Yeah, Jessamine will tell you what they are like. So she doesn't say they're good, they're bad. She will say, "Oh, he's been locking his wife in the basement, and he's waiting for her to die."
They don't just say he's bad, they go full force, or
she'll say something along the lines of like, even though he has nothing to give, he still finds time to visit the orphanage. You know, they're really like, they're really extreme.
So they ham it up even worse than Fable, right?
But you have
to go and ask it that.
Yeah.
Which in Fable you never do, right?
No. But what I mean, when I say they ham it up even worse than that, their descriptions aren't just, "Oh, here is it. Here is a morally dubious circumstance."
They're really very examples. Not but at the same time, it's incredibly clever that that's there.
Like
the mechanic of it is brilliant. And it takes a lot more time to do it that way, because scanning every fucker that you come across, and these are bustling environments.
here's a question then, because as we've talked about before, Dishonored isn't about any of the story, any of the world. What it's really about is this constant battle between order and chaos. That the thing that's woven through all of what's going on in that world is the Church of the Everyman against the Outsider. So, considering that
there's too much analogy with the real world in this. I've had to bite my tongue so hard all the way through.
Wait, it's deliberate.
I know. It's not that. It's the.
So the question is the.
It's like I'm being trolled by it. Is the problem.
I forget what they're called, but like the overseers, like the acolytes of like the Church of the Outsider, right? If you kill them, does that give you chaos points or order points? Because they're all horrible people, but they're all for the Church of the Everyman.
Most of them are evil, though, from my using the heart. I only experienced this stuff really later in my reading about the game, because obviously I was just doing a high chaos. And you know what? Overseers, good night. I'm not about those dudes. Like, I see them, I'm like, what is the most imaginative way that I can kill these people? You know, it's like, it's not about like just jumping on their heads and killing them. It's like, how can I get all of them together, freak them out, and then murderize them? And like, you know, and they're fun to play. But as a matter of fact, that execution one that I did was on an overseer. You know, because they're just generally terrible dudes rolling about the place. But, you know, I think it's a very... It's an incredibly polished experience, which is where Dishonored 1 fell down, I think, for a lot of people. There are some rough edges on Dishonored 1, and I think Dishonored 2 goes a real long way to like addressing those. It's a shame that its story is relatively paper thin, although the story does allow it to take it to some fantastic places. You go to some fantastic areas that the story brings you towards for reasons that's really good. It's just a shame that the kind of tendons holding it all together are a little weak. But all in all, I think it's really good. And I'm assuming you're looking forward to playing more of it.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a wonderful game for the small amount of it that I have played.
Yeah, and because when you get to the end, I have to tell you what happened to me in the last boss, because it was hilarious.
Oh, actually, the as we've mentioned recently, the important question these days is, how long is it? Is it reasonable?
Real long. It took me 21 hours and 30 minutes. But I was doing a really meticulous, like... comb of everything, every bit of lure, every...
That's actually shorter than I was expecting.
Yeah, so a sort of I care a little bit about side quest playthrough is what, about 15, 18?
Yeah, probably. Maybe if you whack it down to normal as well, like it'd probably be quite a lot shorter.
I only play games on normal anyway.
I was tackling it on hard and I died quite a lot.
It's really nice playing it on hard though and feeling like if you...
It's well balanced.
Yeah, if you mess up in a sword fight, then you're done. But my feeling in that situation was I was that much more skilled when I managed to pull off any kind of ridiculous sequence of sword moves, like, and you can a lot. So yeah, it's one of the games where I definitely recommend playing on higher difficulty if you feel like you're up for it.
Yeah,
it's just like as we've spoke about a lot, this is one of a number of great games that came out towards the end of last year. Mm-hmm. And like to get round to playing it, like it's just fitting it in with life, as we've mentioned last Indeed. Summer. Like,
yeah, I mean, like I think for those, I mean, it's a good starting point, I guess, to play it. I would say that it very much is something that's got a lot of payoff if you're a fan of the franchise from the original. Like, I'd say that, you know, anyone that was looking to get into Dishonored should probably think about going back, because it's incredible. I feel like it's incredibly important, and the two games feel very much like two parts of a whole. You know, a little bit feels like, you know, going to see the second Lord of the Rings film without having seen the first, a little bit.
Yeah, but the second one is the best one, then you know you'd love it, even if you hadn't seen the rest.
Yeah, you could have a fun time watching Helm's Deep, but the context isn't there.
I think it's often a big ask to say that you should, I mean, for video games particularly, that you should go back to the more archaic earlier version so that you have the foundation pieces of what ends up not just being a continuation of the story but a more refined gameplay experience, because
the
other thing that's weird about that actually is because you said that the story isn't so much about what it hangs on, and I'm not like, you know, I'm not saying your reading's wrong, I just like it's strange that a game that doesn't hang so much on the story rewards that earlier play.
Well, because it's because the lure is so kind of hard to get inside what's going on there. It's like there are lots of subtle things in the story that I love and could talk about in a more focused way, but I don't really want to like ruin it. But there's so much more instances that have weight based upon what I know of the characters. Like, for example, one of the big characters in it is the Outsider, who is a spirit that
is this
kind
a
of
weird magician
lives in the void. And you've already seen this, so I'm not really ruining too much for Izzy. But in the first game, the Outsider was seen as an agent of chaos that kind of wanted to shake the tree and see what fell out. But this time, he's got a vested interest in your success. And like, so when the game starts for me, and you can tell that he has, that kind of changes your view on the world and how the world works very subtly. But that's not like a whole storyline that's happening there. Like, that doesn't mean that the core storyline is. That does mean that it's more interesting and the stakes have been upped in a way that I now understand.
There's another little interesting thing there, though, which is the Outsider comes along and goes, I can help you out. And you know what you can do? You can tell him to go do one. Say, no. I don't need your help. It's not worth the price.
And this is one of the things. Then you can play through the game without having access to any of the powers. And that's an option. You say no to the Outsider, you don't get your Outsider powers. And then instead of the Outsider going, fair enough, we'll see how that goes, the Outsider goes, but Brodo, like, I need you to succeed at this. But it's very interesting, like, and I think it's a fascinating world, and
God, they put so much effort into creating this game, like the kind of branching possibilities of how you can find your way through it, like the scope of it is far more than I was expecting, and I think harking back to like 2 years ago when we were like, games have got huge and detailed and amazing, this feels like another one that is just going a step beyond, and that means that it's one that should be picked up. It is one that should be picked up. But hey,
one little bit of arcane based news which is particularly for you, Izzy, is have you heard the Prey 2 announcement?
No.
Which is Chris Avellone of all of the best Fallout and Planescape Torment is writing it.
Oh, that changes my perspective on that game that looked like not what I wanted to it probably be the best horror game ever.
Yeah. So, and that's Arkane's next game, so you know, that's a space to watch.
Taste my game face.
We're going to talk about Resident Evil now, because we've had another one. The numbers keep stacking up. We've got all the way up to 7?
It's been very...
7?
And it's only 7 if you don't count the Revelations games, Operation Raccoon City, all of the other games. Zero! Zero! So, yes.
So, zero indexed to 7.
Yeah, exactly. We're at 0.
Of course. Okay, so so Alan, I think you've played more of Resident Evil 7 than anyone else around this table. I haven't played any of it. What's new? What's going on? Yeah. I actually have no idea this time, so everything that you say will be a revelation to me.
Well, I think Resident Evil has kind of pressed a little bit of a reset button in the type of game it wants to be, in a way. With the way that the franchise was going, whereas while it may have been one of, arguably the best one was Resident Evil 4, started the game on a bit of an action orientated way, which just went absolutely nuts in 6. But now they've taken a lot of inspiration from stuff like Amnesia and Outlast and turned it into what was a third person survival horror game turned action game into like a first person survival horror that's actually quite terrifying.
Wait, what? Resident Evil 7's in first person?
Yeah.
See, I really do know nothing.
Yeah. Me too. That's news to me as well.
Yeah, so it's from the get-go, you can tell that it's almost the changing to first person is almost a way of them saying, look, it's different. Even just from a glance at the game, you can see it's a very different type of experience.
But I suppose that's what happened with 4, right? Like, going from like the top down to the over the shoulder, we are thinking of this game in a different way.
Yeah,
going from that fixed camera to over the shoulder, it's almost like slowly but surely they're giving you more and more control over the character and what they can actually do in the making it a bit easier to control. But yeah, the general gist, I don't think this spoils it, but you are someone that is essentially, you're investigating the disappearance of someone close to you, and that takes you to essentially the Texas Chainsaw Massacre house, and you kind of... You are going to this house in the middle of a swamp, I'm guessing in Florida. And there's a family that live there that are very inspired by Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Each one with kind of their different personalities and different role within the family. And you kind of just have to survive them and all of the kind of horrible things that are going around there.
So Resident Evil happens in an evil residence.
Yeah.
Oh my god,
they're bringing it back.
Wait, so does that mean that the action element has really been taken out of it then? Do we not have the taking on hordes of enemies and mashing them up in ridiculous ways with a Chuck Norris roundhouse kick of ultimate destruction?
I would say all of that is gone.
Can I ask actually a more simple question? Apart from the name, is it recognisably Resident Evil in any way?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay. No, that's fine. Like, I know very little about it, but what I've heard sounds like it's a completely offshoot, but it's survival horror.
In so many ways, the new Resident Evil is a homecoming. It's the scariest and most atmospheric Resident Evil probably since the remake of the first one.
The GameCube remake.
Yeah, remake, that was what it's called, our remake, right? Oh, God. But, for me, it's really interesting because it's taken all of these elements from these popularized games like your Outlasts and your Amnesias and those games, those critical darlings that have been so lauded for not having combat. And it brought combat into it, and it makes me feel really guilty because I'm like, oh, this is better than them because it's got guns in it. And it's kind of like, you know, you have to take your kind of wanky hat off and go, well, actually, you know what, this is better, and it is still terrifying with the guns.
Wait, Jay, you have to take your wanky hat off. Yeah. Not a game for me then.
Yeah, no, not at all.
Jonathan Blow has got nothing to do with it.
Nothing to do with this again.
Podcast title.
But I mean, like, Alan, how have you found like the atmosphere and how that kind of like for me, it reflects a lot about where Resident Evil came from.
Well, I think for me, it's because I guess I come from with Resident Evil a different place. That the first Resident Evil game I played was 4, and then after that, I probably got about 5 hours into the remake, and it's definitely it feels. Well, you're saying in a similar kind of, in tonally, it feels similar to the remake, except for the fact that it's far less cheesy in the way that it's in terms of like some of the characters.
That's a really, really, really good point, because that kind of Resident Evil ham-fistedness has been taken away by these characters. I mean, it's kind of difficult to talk about like without doing a real like really broad spoilers, and like I in talking about how the game actually plays and how you engage in the combat and would involve kind of giving away some of it, and so I want to bring it to the floor, is if that's something that we can talk about.
See, I'd quite like to, because so here's an issue, and there's maybe something we should have talked about off air to make that.
They're all going to hear it now.
Yeah. I know.
This is how the podcast gets made.
So, like, I have a feeling that part of its success is people being roughly blind, and to the point that they deliberately didn't mention it was a Resident Evil game when they trailed it on VR.
See, this is an interesting story, because when they were demoing, I think PlayStation VR originally, like a couple of years ago now, they had a demo called Kitchen. And I don't even think anyone really knew at the time it had to do with Capcom. It was just kind of there with the smaller team showing off this demo of, it's essentially just you are tied to a chair while seemingly someone tortures you in a way, or some like semi or approaches you. But then it turned out that that was actually the tech demo for Resident Evil. But we only found out afterwards, even that they're, I think at one of the E3 conferences for Sony, they brought up Kitchen and then changed the title to Resident Evil, kind of announcing, yeah, this was the same game. You've technically played some Resident Evil already, and now it's 6 months out before it's released.
I mean, is this, and I don't know if we even have the knowledge around the table, but I mean, I'm reminded of 10 Cloverfield Lane here when we talk about this, that was sort of conceived as a film called Cellar. Well, it was quite atmospheric, you know what I mean? Like, it was all about a sort of slightly different element, and then J.J. Abrams got involved and it rolled into the Cloverfield world. And I'll say little more than that.
So
without
the question you're asking was this made into Resident Evil 7?
Was it picked up and rolled into a Resident Evil? Was it picked up and moved into Resident Evil? Was it taken up by Capcom and moved along? Or
I see. I don't know the answer to that. But from what the game is doing and how the game plays and how many nods within it are about echoing Resident Evil, it feels incredibly deliberate.
Okay.
I mean, like, in a kind of non-spoiler way, the shotgun puzzle is back in a new form.
Okay, yeah.
You know, things like that. Like, little bits. I mean, like, maybe they could have been homages to Resident Evil.
Yeah.
But now that they're inside a thing that's called Resident Evil, everything feels very deliberate.
Yeah. Okay.
So many of the mechanics in it, while it is first person, are still very Resident Evil in the same way, kind of having, you know, like, oh, you need to find the scorpion key and you need to find a thing this shape to get through the door. You have an inventory that's limited that expands throughout the game, and juggling that and which items you keep with you. So the fact that there are kind of safe rooms that you go into where you save.
Yeah.
And so not the typewriters this time, but it's little kind of cassette recorders
that
you go up to, but it's a lot of this stuff just makes it feel very Resident Evil while not feeling familiar but not familiar at the same time. It's, weird.
Okay, that sounds interesting. We didn't really answer the question of how willing we are to go with spoilers.
I'm gonna set this up though. I think that we're like not. I think Resident Evil is a game that would this Resident Evil in general is a game that I feel at the moment I'm probably about like 6 or 7 hours in, and I feel I've been taking my time with it. Mm. And I've died quite a lot because it's hard.
Yeah.
Actually, and that resource element is back.
You know, so it's Chris Redfield's run through.
Yes, it's a Chris Redfield run through, and and you are like, you know, there are points in the game where like I've had to go, you know, like I've got like made a dent into an area, got an item that's incentivized maybe me going backwards, and I've like looked at the challenges ahead of me, stuck my head in a few doors and gone, I need to go back. You know, and that's like a thing that Resident Evil hasn't done for ages. Like, Resident Evil's always been pushing you forward. It's like that, but sometimes I'm like, no, I've got a thing that might lead to more ammo, a better gun, because every piece matters.
Yeah.
And kind of having this really new experience whilst engaging with that old Resident Evil brain for me has been a wonderful experience. And I'm really liking it. I mean, with how much you've played, Alan, is it still carrying it forward for you?
Yeah, it's definitely, I'm still loving it. And it's, you know, it's taken like interesting turns, and there's things happening in it I wasn't expecting. And it's come to a point I'm at now, it's like, oh, I didn't think this was going to be part of this game, but it's a perfect balance between a game like Outlast and the way the Resident Evil was. Giving you that great environment to explore in this super creepy house where every time you turn a corner, you don't know if something's just going to be there around the corner waiting for you. Even if it literally is someone sitting in a chair that doesn't move, and it's terrifying for some reason. It just is. It's hard to explain.
So I'm wondering, so it sounds like they've managed to create an excellent fresh take on what Resident Evil is in a way that's turned it into a game that has, at the same time as being intrinsically Resident Evil, has taken on all of the good things that have been happening, a lot of the good things that have been happening in the horror in the horror gaming world outside of that. But does it like fit in the universe in a neat way? Does it fit within
Resident Evil? Definitely. From the very early game, if you're in Resident Evil in the way that I have been, it appears like, for me, my hopes are it's the grounded payoff for the most ridiculous shit that franchise has pulled. You know, and it's starting to feel a lot like that for me. But the story is not one of Resistance versus Biochemical Corporation. That's not what the plot is.
Mm-hmm.
Like, well, Alan's description of the plot is the plot. And you're not Claire, you're not Jill, you're not Chris, you're not Leon, you're not any of these, let's be honest, quite dated video game characters.
Mm.
You are the man having a shit time, which is the character that we like now. You know, that's kind of like the popular character. And that's one of the interesting things about it is I think it's an excellent video game from what I've played so far. I don't think, because it's more of like it's like Resident Evil as a franchise assessed the gaming landscape and said, like, what can we do to be relevant, and made that game. It's not like, you know, the reinvention of the wheel that Resident Evil 4 was that then changed video games forever. You know, this isn't going to inspire, you know, massive franchises like Gears of War and things like that aren't going to come spilling out of Resident Evil 7, I don't think.
No.
You know, because it's much more just like, it's more like a temperature check at the current climate. So I don't think it's probably not going to be regarded as such a classic, but at the same time, it's got a lot more integrity. And that's something that Resident Evil hasn't had, and that is weird. Like, Resident Evil turning up with integrity, trying to sell you on this brilliant mix of classic Western horror with J-Shock elements really brilliantly threaded through it, like in a real together kind of way, is just a surprise. And that's probably the best thing about it.
You reckon so too, Alan?
Yep.
I know. Shit. Well.
Also, sorry, just to say, it's a bit early. I haven't completed it. Right now, we talk on this podcast a little bit about a certain kind of video game tier.
Mm-hmm.
Which we've put what the witches, the witches, yeah, there. What else has been on our on our weird tier?
The Witness. No, that's my weird tier. Okay, Hitman.
Games that are kind of pushing the envelope forward in a very particular that we haven't yet quite quantified way, but they feel like they're like a video game plus a bit more.
Mm-hmm.
For me, right now, my experience of Resident Evil is it could be that. But he has to carry that ball all the way to the end zone.
Talking of other long-standing Japanese game series, though, like Resident Evil goes back forever. This is the... Are you applauding? You're applauding my thing.
Fucking genius. That is fucking genius.
So Resident Evil goes back forever. It is something that goes to the heart of like what video games have been for so many people for so long. And another one that exists in that space and we've had a new version of lately is Pokemon. And Wayne, you're going to tell us about the new Pokemon.
I will
not go.
No, this is a Pokemon sit. So all of those people that have been sitting at their computers, you know, spoofing GPS locations so that they can go and take gyms in Pokemon Go can just sit and play an actual Pokemon game that's a far richer and more filling experience that doesn't involve you being outside if you don't want that.
Because you don't have to be outside. You definitely don't have to talk to other people whilst you're playing this one.
No. I mean, talking to other people is very much optional in Pokemon Go as well, but this one is absolutely unnecessary. Actually, like having said that, Pokemon still has... still becomes quite a lot richer if there are people that you are playing it with, even though you mostly play against people.
Yeah, so, actually, I suppose that is probably why Pokemon Go exists to a certain degree, because Pokemon was always designed to have a significant social element to it.
Yes, anyway. Exactly that. So, I mean, so I'll do the 30 seconds thing, right? I love to do. Pokemon, you are a child that is far too young to be out in the world by themselves, who meets a professor. You always meet a professor typically named after a tree, but I think is a Kui Kui a type of tree? Because that's what this one is.
Wait, looking at me, I'm not a herbologist.
Where's a botanist when we need one?
Yeah, exactly. Why didn't we invite a botanist along today? But you meet a professor who studies Pokemon, which are these monsters who is effectively...
There could be someone who doesn't know.
The entire animal species of the planet who conveniently fit in balls... that you will throw at them to capture, and then you release them from the balls to occasionally fight each other. So basically it's like a really, like for animals it's a really dystopian future, but for us it's a cutesy fucking game about, like, you know, stylized cockfighting or whatever.
Cockfighting with fireballs.
But there's lots of, it started, as you mentioned, like 20 years ago with 150 Pokemon that are the Pokemon that are famous in Pokemon Go, plus a couple of babies from the next one. But they've released with every generation, this is number 7 now. I think it's number 7. They've released another set of monsters. So they're
God, I could have had an even better segue.
Yeah.
Oh, if only I'd known. Okay, fair enough.
No, your one went to the heart.
But yeah, so we're on the 7th generation now, and they're up to about 750 of them. They don't all appear in any game, but there's around 300 or so of them in this iteration that you can wander about. And, yeah.
So what's this iteration called?
So this is these are Sun and Moon. Mm-hmm. So there's always two of them, and then there's normally a subsequent one,
yeah,
right?
Which this time is Star, and is that exclusive for the next console?
Is it?
Rumor has it it's
going to be on the
Nintendo Switch.
Or we'll get to the Switch later. Are we going to get Nintendo Switch? yeah, I like that one. Okay,
you can just click for the seg.
Sweet. What's fresh?
Actually, yeah. So this is the thing, right? So Pokemon has effectively been the same game for a hell of a long time, right? You are this child that goes out, is given a Pokemon, and you use that Pokemon to battle weak and another Pokemon that you catch, then when you have a sufficient number of Pokemon, you take your Pokemon to a gym. And you take those Pokemon to a gym and you fight for the gym. And if you win that battle, you get a badge. And that badge is effectively your key to the next area. And gyms have gone.
What?
Yeah, exactly. So gyms have existed for six generations of Pokemon. And now...
20 years.
Yeah, 20 years. And now they... And now they're not a thing anymore. And instead, what they have is something that's similar, but actually quite distinct. So instead of that, your missions are called trials. So what you do is when you've reached a sufficient strength and number of Pokemon, you will attempt a trial, which is based around a Pokemon typing, much like the gyms. However, these trials can be very distinct, right? They can... one of them is... Go and collect me items using one of the new Pokemon abilities that you have, right? And Pokemon abilities is something else we should talk about, I think, at some point. But yeah, you can go and collect these using a Pokemon ability. Or actually, can you think of a couple more offhand? Because I know that you've played quite a lot of it as well.
Yeah, well, there's one where you watch some dancers and you've got to tell the difference between the dances.
Yeah, and that trolls that you, doesn't great. It? It trolls you pretty hilariously as well, that one. But I won't spoil it. It's magic. It's absolutely magic.
Yeah, but you went, yeah, it's kind of, so all of the trials are kind of, it's a really unique thing. I think each island has a few different ones.
Yeah.
And then after you do all the trials, you have to fight a, what do they call it?
Kahunas.
Kahunas.
Although after each trial, there's a totem Pokemon. After each trial,
there's a totem Pokemon, which is essentially just like a hyped up version of a normal Pokemon. And so instead of fighting a gym leader with their one, you've got to fight this, essentially a wild Pokemon that is just kind of special.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, after you've done the trials of the island, you have to fight the Kahuna, which is kind of the town leader of each, like the island leader. So each island will has a Kahuna that is their like their elder or whatever.
Is it a Pokemon?
Yes, no, the Kahuna is a person.
Oh, okay. So
this, yeah, or I think it's a woman or one of them.
Yeah.
So you'll fight that, and then as you fight all of these, you will get new, instead of getting gym badges, you get these thing called Z crystals, which you can give to a Pokemon to give them an extra special ability. So instead of just getting a badge and saying, look at this nice shiny badge, it then adds an element to
your instead Pokemon. Of it just being collect Pokemon, fight Pokemon, you now have a little bit weirder little game elements along the route to, first of all, being able to do a stranger battle against a Pokemon that you will never be able to fight in another circumstance. So you've got this particular standout odd battle that you are crawling towards through not just grinding, but actually finding little oddities in the world. And then after you've done that, then you fight the equivalent of a gym leader again. Mm. So you still have the classic element in there.
Yeah. It's just kind of with a different, I guess, with a different twist.
Okay. So no, it sounds like a good way of still maintaining the heart of what people expect from that game, but mixing it up with some more interesting elements.
Well, that's it. It's not a entire sea change, but it's a definite evolution, which is a very apt word, I think.
So these badges that give you abilities, do they work like a HM in the old Pokemon?
So I mentioned abilities earlier. That's that idea of there are special abilities that you can teach Pokemon has sort of gone. So the Z crystals add a fifth move to Pokemon's repertoire if they are holding the associated, what do they call them? Like, it's something Z, like Normalium Z and...
Yeah.
Like so there'll be Furium Z and stuff like that. Yeah,
so
there'll be
one for each kind of... So you have a fire one, a fighting one, a grass one, a ghost type, and there'll be some that which very specific Pokemon use. I think through pre-ordering the game, you get a baby version of a Snorlax and a Snorlium Z.
Yeah, which gives him an extra power. There's a special...
So what do we mean by extra powers then? Because I thought what you were suggesting is that you needed these extra powers to be able to complete these weird tasks, which would have meant that it's not something that exists within the battle system. But it sounds like it is something that exists.
No, the other abilities actually is the HM system, right? So that TMs still exist, which are just little things that you can pick up and use to give your Pokemon moves to use in battle. But previously there were HMs that were moves that you used to Pokemon to explore the world. Now the story issues you with Pokemon that you can summon that have these abilities. So there is, if on the first island, you get a Tauros that has a special Tauros charge. And you can jump on Tauros and use him to smash rocks. But that doesn't mean that... So you're not ruining the Tauros that you're using to battle by giving it a move that reduces its move repertoire.
Instead.
Yeah. But the Zed crystals take that one step further. When you get a Zed crystal, they're something that you can use in battle. So you actually get a... You can use your four moves that you've taught your Pokemon, plus you can use your Zed move. And
what's that going to mean for the competitive state of the game?
Yeah, that's exactly what I was thinking. That sounds like some OP fucking Pokemon are coming at.
It's a lot less broken than Mega Pokemon were. Okay. So Mega Pokemon used to be, you'd get Mega Pokemon and it's like, I've won. Right, it's like EX Pokemon and the Pokemon card game. It's kind of... So they've wound that back. So Zed moves can only be used once. There's like normally one like really hyper-powered attack. Or they're used to modify status attacks as well. So Tail Whip is a move that you would use to lower the defense of an opposing Pokemon. It also, if you use the Zed version of it, it also boosts your own attack power as well as lowering the defense of the opponent. So you've got moves that... And I mean, that's the thing. Like, the battle system still has quite all of the hidden depth. And what they've done is they've moved stuff that's required to play the game out of that. To allow the depth in the battling to like be explored and expanded upon a little bit more.
With, as you were saying, with the HMs, I guess to maybe explain that a bit differently, you've got the HMs and TMs, and one a TM was, they're both ways of teaching a Pokemon a move, a new move that they possibly could learn on their own, but you can just say, oh, here's a TM for Psychic, and you can just teach it to a Pokemon that's applicable. TMs, you could always overwrite it, so if you wanted to learn a new move or if they learned something new that was better, you could overwrite and still have your four core moves that you are refining as the Pokemon gets more powerful. But HM was permanent. You couldn't overwrite it. It was stuck there, and you also needed it to be able to traverse the environment. But now those HMs are now the special Pokemon you can call upon. Like, for example, use that if you wanted to be able to fly around the world. You would have to teach a Pokemon Fly, which they would have as a permanent move that you couldn't get rid of.
So you'd all crowd on the back of a Spearow because didn't mind janking up your Spearow.
Yeah, but now you essentially have a page that calls a Charizard to you to then fly on your Charizard to another part of the world. And as you're saying, that means that just the combat itself, as you say, you've got more freedom in the moves that you can use that without having to worry about, oh, I need to keep Flash so I can explore a cave without being in darkness.
Yeah, exactly. And because you don't only use it to ruin your Pokemon, but you also have to use it to ruin your party because you need to have that Pokemon in your six when you're playing the game.
Yeah, which it's all about trying to get one Pokemon that's a dumping ground for as many fucking
exactly.
as possible that you're never seriously going to play. Interesting fact, I caught a Missingno in the first Pokemon.
Oh,
turned out it was a flying Kangaskhan. Which tore up people on Pokemon Stadium.
So, yeah, I mean, like, so in terms of, like, actually, there's a whole other element to it now. And this partly is, you know, where it falls down in a minute because of going back to that old question about, you know, how long do we have to play video games these days? And there's this whole other element of things that you can do via the menu. There's a like your web-based bit where you have people, you like anyone that you communicate with via the link system, like sort of goes to this sort of theme park. And then you can talk to them in the theme park and send them to different things, which gives you activities that you can yourself do in the theme park. And then there's Pokepelago, which is another island group, because the game takes place in an island group. And it you can sort of collect items there and collect Pokebeans, which are used in this other thing, which is Pokemon Refresh, which is this sort of like, I guess, Nintendog style fucking stroke your Pokemon and feed it beans, which is stuff that makes the fighting experience better if you've do that because they're more likely to land critical hits, etc. But
does it feel like then that these things are, I suppose, when games want all of your time, I think it's kind of a combined thing. It's out of an understanding that for a lot of the people that are buying the game, that's the one game they're going to have and the one game that they're going to play.
Yep.
But also it feels like they are saying, you must play me and no other game.
I don't feel it in that way. For me, it's more this idea that Pokemon has had so many iterations that without changing the core element of the game, of the way that the battles work and leveling up and evolving, they keep trying to figure out new things they can add to the game to make it seem different, with doing the fact that there's been a game pretty much every year for however many years. And these are extra modes. It's like, okay, so the battling's still normal. We've done a couple of extra bits of that. But here's this mode that we can put on the back of the box as a bullet point to say it's an extra bit.
Some of the stuff that you're talking about, the last one I played was X and Y.
Yep.
And one of the things that I thought was really good about X and Y is it kind of was the blowout of kind of the secrets of Pokemon effort values, where they created mini games and stuff that, like, made it much more accessible for everyone.
You know? Yeah, yeah, yeah. And they give you this...
And this kind of ease of use stuff that's been going on. And it sounds like quite a lot of the stuff that you're saying sound like they're like iterations on that.
Yes, they are. And I mean, like the Pokepelago element, one of the things that you can do there is directly train effort values. So they're certainly part of... Like, it's all about enriching the broader experience. But I guess, in a way, by exposing it, what it does is it makes it feel like an obligation. Right. And like I said, so when I'm playing, you know, I play it from like I maybe have an hour. Right. But once I've gone through the, you know, the refresh after a couple of battles, and then I go to the Pokepelago and I collect all of the beans that have dropped and I send them off on their quest to look in a cave to get items, because you get evolution stones through this quest. So it's kind of relevant. Right. And you send another bunch of Pokemon out to the gym to train their effort values or level up, which is another... That's actually really good. Like, you don't have to grind every single Pokemon you want to use directly. You can use this island. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But once you've gone through and done all of that, because they're a timed element.
Yeah.
You set them doing it and they do it for X amount of hours. Real life hours, not hours that you're playing the game. But if I pick it up tomorrow morning, having done that, they would have finished.
Will be back.
Yeah, like, they will be back. Yeah, here's what you've done. Now are you going to send me to do it again? But once I've done all of that, that's most of my hour. That's most of the time that I'm going to spend playing it today. At which point I'm like,
just playing. Yeah, I'm playing manager.
Exactly.
What is wrong with you?
Exactly. So, and the other thing is that the way that the gyms and trials, sorry, kahunas and trials are structured is actually a lot more rewarding than it has been for a long time. Because the game, like, it guides you via a story and you're sort of carried along in it in a way that you haven't been in Pokemon games for a long while. It used to be, you're going to that town, here's a big old route, just walk along it. The routes are a lot shorter now and they're punctuated by things happening and people will talk to you and that talking to you will have relevance in some way quite a lot of the time.
Just saying like, hi, my name is Bugcatcher Bill. Have you seen my excellent shorts?
Yeah, so like trainers... So trainers, like, you know, trainers that just stand about and literally any hour of the day or night are in that spot are still a thing.
Just waiting for you.
But you are also, yeah, you are the only reason they are there. And then they fight you and they don't even go home. They just stay there.
No, they've just worked out how to do an amazing selection of Pokemon calls and they never need to move because the Pokemon come to them.
But they don't bother fighting you with the new ones that they've caught. They don't bother fighting you with the new ones that they've caught. They just stand there and repeat the same phrase over and over. Like, it's a standard RPG cliche, and it would be very sad if it went away now, I guess. But at the same time, it has that same sort of bizarre element to it, right? But
when playing the game, you're talking about the idea that, like, there are a lot of people to talk to and a lot of punctuation points as you're travelling around, and you do kind of get these on, like, smaller quests, and they'll be like, oh, if you collect all of these things, then come back and see me later. But I found an issue with that in the amount of, because there are long periods of time between me playing the game, that because there isn't necessarily like a list of objectives and quests that you can check up on and say, like, you know, say in a game like Fallout, where you'd be like, oh, that optional objective there, I can select it and set a marker on the map. I just forget where people are starting to go. It's like, oh, I've collected all these things. Where am I supposed to take it now? I have no idea.
No, it's true. And then...
But it does sound like a really good, like, kind of mashup of the formula, because for me, the point where I went to, like, well, I'm playing a Pokemon game and I'm heading towards what I have preconceived as the gym, and then someone goes, like, I've got something other for you to do than battle. Like, I'll be like, what? I don't even know what to do with this information. You know, because it's so, because that's one of the things for me. I feel that as I've got older, Pokemon, like the playing of Pokemon, has become so much more of a science rather than like a kind of joy. It's like, I play this new Pokemon.
Hold on now. Since when did science stop being joy?
That's for another podcast.
Okay.
I'm not on it.
Jonathan Blow might be there.
Yeah. Jonathan Blow's podcast. Yeah. But it's taken away that kind of story, you know, that kind of my investment into the world. I've felt more and more and more disconnected from the playing of Pokemon.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's always just been like, you know, like a number crunch. And now, like, with some of the stuff that you're saying, it sounds like it's something that, like, at least has some sort of atmosphere of a game beyond that.
Yes, exactly.
And that sounds lovely.
It is clearly, actually, it's obviously a richer experience. Like, there's no denying it, just from the way it's animated and stuff. It's richer. Although they've been far too ambitious for the hardware at points. There's this thing called Battle Royale, which involves four Pokemon at once, just take, like, and you can just hit anyone, right? You've got four different trainers with X amount of Pokemon, and you can just shoot at anyone.
It's like a fucking Royal Rumble of Pokemon!
Yeah, there's a Royal Rumble of Pokemon, which
you can't
is,
hack it.
But, yeah, the frame rate really stutters. Like, so really stutters.
That also sounds great, though. It's just like, you know, when everyone's doing all of their Pokemon moves and it's all coming together and everything's, like, breaking. It's got that, because I kind of like that about, like, you know, the kind of old PC CRPGs, you know, when everyone's doing their powers, everyone's got their
and
then the computer just goes B-sod and you're like, that's how hard I am.
So I guess is the reason that they feel like they can get away with putting something like that in the game then, because they know that it's coming to the Switch as well.
Oh yeah. sorry yeah, should
have. I think it's very possible. I think there's sort of weird rumours that when the first reveal trailer for Pokemon, they showed a lot of behind the scenes stuff of essentially just showing character models. But the character models they showed were way higher detail than should be able to do on the 3DS.
Mm-hmm. I mean, so, like, the launch list that I've seen for the Switch for this year, like, you know, games that will be out at some point this year, and I guess that's the seg.
The seg's been.
Yeah.
Did you miss the seg?
Well, no.
It was that smooth.
The problem was that we've mentioned it in passing. It was been mentioned in passing before, so I didn't know if we were still doing it. Okay. You know what I mean? Like,
Wayne.
Thank you.
That's the seg.
I really shouldn't drink before coming on this.
So, Wayne, launch lineup, Nintendo Switch.
So, yeah. So, like, it's on there. It's scheduled for December, and normally it takes a little bit longer than that, right?
Oh, okay.
So it's obviously been worked on. It's on its way. They know about it. And it probably fits that there is normally the two versions. Although I don't recall Pokemon Z ever coming out.
No, I didn't.
No, so, I mean, there's a gap for that. But typically, there is a third one that goes along with the releases of the series that has a sort of twist to it, and it makes sense for that to be on the Switch.
Yeah. So what else is on the Switch launch lineup? every time we mention it.
Well, I mean, should we do the console? Should we talk about the console and then go to the games, or should we talk about the games?
What
as
console?
Well? I'm deliberately not doing it.
Let's start with the games. We're on the games already. So
let's start with it. Okay, so I mean, like, the big one that's also coming out on the Wii U, which, as far as I'm concerned, removes the point of getting one, is the new Zelda game, right? Breath of the Wild? Because I got this wrong a million times last time we talked about it.
That's right, Breath of the Wild.
Which looks like an anime. actually, from the trailer that I've seen.
It's like adult Link, but cel-shaded.
Yeah.
You know, and let's be honest, like, you know, adult Link's always been a bit of a...
No, but when I say boy. Looks like an anime, I don't mean it visually looks like an anime. I mean, like, the way that the characters are interacting with each other in it and the action that is inherent in that trailer reminds me of anime. Okay. That's what I mean.
I mean, voice acting is a new thing. Yeah, isn't it?
Yeah, that's not.
See, I've seen very little of the like launch run up stuff. I saw quite a lot of technical stuff on the way out. So what's it kind of look like now? Does Link talk?
Yeah. Does Link talk? Link may not talk, actually.
Link doesn't talk. Zelda talks though.
Zelda definitely talks.
They haven't really gone all out on the voice acting though.
No,
it's not.
Well, I mean, I think it's weird though because they. On the when they did the big Switch reveal, they showed during the actual conference, they showed a Japanese trailer, and some of the voice acting was really horribly over the top. But then they released an American one at the same time on YouTube, and it's fine. The voice acting is all right.
Because I imagine that I like when I actually imagine what that would sound like in my head, it's like squeaky anime.
Yeah,
like I imagine Zelda being like, "Hello, Link." And like, that kind of makes me crawl a bit. Is it better than that?
I think I've only seen the Japanese one. I've not gone.
Yeah,
not
gone I mean, there's a moment one. where Zelda cries, and it's just
It's a little bit much
over the top.
It's a little bit much.
It's ridiculous. But in the American one, it's just kind of a normal cry. It's fine. This works for us.
So there's a fairly limited launch lineup, though, isn't there? I mean, there's maybe six now. I think they've added one more thing to that box in the top left of the poster thing that I've been seeing flying about on YouTube. Oh, sorry, Facebook and Twitter and stuff. One of those games is Bomberman, which on first pass looks amazing, and what I've seen of it in the trailer, it looks like Bomberman. Not Bomberman with all the bullshit, not Bomberman with the weird fucking quest, but just five people that are just trying to blow each other up, right?
As Bomberman, though, not like as some sort of extreme...
As
classic Bomberman.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's got a slightly unnecessary pseudo-isometric
to the Xbox 360 generation metal as fuck
Bomberman. Was it called Bomberman Zero, wasn't it?
Yes.
So, because
it's Bomberman R.
Bomberman's had the same sort of struggles that Super Monkey Ball has had.
The struggles of Bomberman.
Like, you know,
podcast style.
How many have we got so far? I mean, I've got four written down here.
We're going to have Nintendo to cut some Click being one of them, right?
No. Nintendo.
Right, write that down.
Yeah. Go on, get the onomatopoeia out for that shit. But Bomberman's had struggles in the same way that Monkey Ball did, in that conceptually it's amazing, but unfortunately the best one was the first one. So no one's had any reason to buy one since, frankly. Because even though...
Bomberman tournament on the GBA.
GBA was really good, actually.
Yeah.
But apparently it's got a £60 price point.
I know definitely this for Zelda.
Yeah.
Picking up Zelda on the Switch is going to cost £60.
Isn't there like a potential that that's like the markup before we realise what the prices are? You know, because quite often like pre-orders aim higher for a product.
Okay, no, to be but... out. We're seeing pre-order prices.
Yeah, saying like, we're seeing whether or not we can get away charging £59.99 for this.
Well, no. That they're not going to. No one's going to pay more than 50 quid for a game, even in this day and age.
Or have Nintendo outly said that that's what's going on?
Well, no, that's the RRPs that I've been seeing flying about for it.
That does still mean that their RRP is £10 more than PS4 and Xbox One,
which is a fairly big ask, right? Because it's not as powerful, it's not as grand, and like, here's the thing: the games that are being pitched at it feel like the sort of things that you would expect to be preloaded onto it.
Mm-hmm. There's some sort of weird shovelware game, isn't there?
You that's mean coming 1-2 Switch?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's not even that. So here's the thing, right? Wii Sports.
That should be Wii Sports. Yeah.
Wii Sports, right? Made the Wii. That they went, PR, this demonstrates everything that we think that is new about this console. have at it.
Punch your dad in the face.
Yeah, and so many people have a Wii simply because
they wanted to punch their dad in the face.
Yeah, that bit, that one element was fun. Now, if
it's not as fun when your dad's punching you in the face.
Because a 1-2 Switch appears to be exactly that. The idea of what can we do that is different? How does this console stand apart from the ones that we've done before? But unfortunately, no one's going to find that shit out because no one's going to pay 60 quid for what is effectively a tech demo.
I've heard that beyond this, that Nintendo are kind of making a bit of a mess of like the release of the Switch. Like, not just that their games are too high priced and there's not enough of them at launch, but that the message after that initial showing, their initial trailer, has been a bit off point. Now, I haven't been following the Switch that closely, so I'm really interested to hear what you might have to say.
Can I talk about my favourite one? They're going to charge for online and they're going to give you one retro game a month. Now, after that month is done, they're going to take it away.
Wait. So you're saying after we had like Xbox charging for online on their own, right?
Yeah.
And like everyone was up in arms about that, but we all kind of got on board because they were offering a good online service. And then Sony turns up and they're like, "We want to charge for online, but we need to make this worth your money. So we will give you at least a game a month, usually a lot more than a game a month on each of your Sony consoles, so that we feel that we can charge you for this online service." And then Microsoft goes, "Oh shit, if Sony's giving away these games, these good indie games, then we need to get on board as well." So they've already got all of like their infrastructure set up, and then they're offering some good games and like some pretty sizable discounts on others as well. Nintendo gets to the party late, still has their idiot friend code bullshit, doesn't know how to do online thing, and then on top of charging people for online, when at this point the other two consoles have realised that the only way they can get away with it is by offering some good games along with it as well, they're saying you can have one ROM a month that you only have for that month.
And I've already got Super Mario Brothers 4 times.
Oh my god. No, but you'll have it 5 times, but only for a month.
Okay.
I mean, not to mention as well about the fact that you will need a smartphone app to be able to use voice chat.
I've heard, for voice chat specifically? Because, yeah, I've heard that I've heard that some of that was over-egged, or at the very least, they have wound back rapidly from that.
Well, the way that good old Reggie was talking about it was that, well, you want to be able to, you want to take it wherever you go. So we thought, why put the voice chat in the console when it'd be easier just to have it on your phone? Because then you can chat wherever you are.
Oh, that's so sad though, because I can see how they got there. Like, I can. It's like, oh, you know, everyone's like, hey, got a phone. Like, yeah. They're not going to get a Switch over a smartphone. So we'll assume they've already got one of those. And so, you know, like, we'll get this app and they can all talk to each other. It's like forgetting that everyone's already got Skype, you know?
Which will probably end up being a better surface if they just use Skype.
But of course, like, Xbox Live, it uses, like, this pretty much the same, network setup.
They're calling it Skype encoding. Or Link on Xbox.
Well, because Microsoft own it, like, when Microsoft bought Skype, like, on Xbox One, the voice chat is now way better than any of the other consoles, because they're using the same tech. Yeah, it just makes all the difference. We've got a situation where Nintendo appears to have created a console that we're all excited about at the initial sighting, and then they've carefully undermined themselves every subsequent step along the way.
I think that's the thing. I still think the console itself is cool, and I still like the console itself. I still like the idea and this.
It comes down to the games that are on it and the experience that you can have on it.
I think it's because they put themselves in a weird position where the Wii U didn't do anywhere near as well as they were hoping it would do. They were expecting Wii success again with the Wii U. And so the fact that it flopped so horribly meant that they had to kind of get to the next generation, the next console for them very quickly. So they've essentially made a console, built it, started manufacturing it, and then started giving it to developers. And so they have practically no third parties have had time to make.
But they've got all of those ROMs. They've got all of those ROMs.
Yeah, it's like they're sitting on a treasure trove. Like, Nintendo, you know, they just had to like wake up and go like, oh, okay, everyone that gets a Switch in the first month gets like all the Final Fantasies and Earthbound.
So you know, here's like, the problem.
You didn't have Earthbound before.
So here's the problem that they've got, right, is that they, so they're going to end up having to run the Ambassador program again anyway. I imagine. Because here's the thing, right?
Before we go on, what's the Ambassador Program?
So the Ambassador Program was what they did on the 3DS, where basically a bunch of people went out and bought it at DOT, and everyone else went, you're all right, man. And so what they did was they dropped the price fairly dramatically about 6 months in, and all of those people that bought it immediately were up in arms. So they were like, here's like 30 downloadable games that you can have.
Interestingly, they've held on to those, though. Like, those are access to ROMs that you can't actually get off the store. And they've really... And I was always expecting, oh, there's going to come a point where there's, like, a, you know, like, a free-for-all on those. And that's never come. Like, I can't have Metroid Fusion on my 3DS because I'm not an ambassador. I can't have Yoshi's Island on anything, which is ridiculous because it's one of the most important platform games ever made. But they really stuck to it.
I don't know why they couldn't charge for them though, because I'm sure for a lot of them, people would buy them.
But Nintendo,
and that's weird because
keep on playing the violin while the bones on fire.
Like, here's the problem: it's conceptually actually quite good, right? I mean, the idea, the logic behind it is. Sound, if not better than sound, right? It's like the gamepad from the Wii U, but better with detachable joysticks, and you can give one to your mate, stand it up, and just play it wherever you are. Great.
I'm actually quite excited by the prospect of all, like, a bunch of us owning Switches, and then just kind of hanging out and being like, do you want to play Mario Kart? Let's just...
Let's do it.
Question that I haven't actually asked yet, which maybe somebody knows the answer to. If we're talking about the prices of games, do we know how much a console is going to cost?
Oh, Jesus Christ.
We was going to save that to the end.
Sorry?
280.
What?
£50
modern, they said it would cost.
That's
you can currently buy a PS4 with multiple games for less than that.
Oh, my good lord. Is this the cost of Brexit?
This is actually the cost of Brexit.
Well, I think that's the thing. I mean, they're bringing their prices closer into line with America because America are paying $2.99. Mm-hmm. So we're, you know, in terms of parity with the euro, isn't it?
That we're paying
very close. Yeah. I think not exactly the same.
But $2.99 in America is like without tax, though, right? So
because it's $2.99 America. It's also $2.99 Europe. But that will be with the tax rolled in, right?
But you have to remember that the estimates, and from what Nintendo was saying, is it sounded like it was going to be 230.
Mm-hmm.
And backpedaled that shit. Like, everything with their campaign is just seems completely wrong. I mean, like, let's be honest, this Nintendo, they're only going to make five of them anyway, aren't they? Bring them out and watch people, like, watch the same six dudes beat each other to death in a stupid game at night.
I think that kind of...
Well, it's sold out everywhere, apparently. Pre-orders are done. But they're probably pre-orders that are done by people that have suit them up so they can try and sell them on an additional resale, and everyone's going to go, no, you're all right, son. You can sit on 15 Nintendo Switches. Off you go.
Probably a third of them are scalpers. But it's also, I think, it's the same thing I was saying before about they're trying to put this into production as quick as possible because they're trying to have a much quicker turnaround. So they've had time to manufacture them.
They don't have.
But that motivation is like, I guess, all of the motivations are obvious, but also the conclusion feels wrong. So because, like I say, the idea about the technology of it, right? You plug it into your TV, you take it with you, you can run whatever game you're doing wherever you're going. And what else has that? Right, that home console on the move thing.
Indeed, but it's a genius move.
But
without, seems like one at the moment.
I need to want to play the games. Yeah, and they need people like me to want to get it at DOT.
Can we talk about an aspect that I'm a little bit hung up on? So they've announced a new Mario game. What the fuck is going on there?
I want, I want to propose a question.
There's no way that Mario'd be let into America.
I
want
to propose a question to Izzy because he probably hasn't seen the trailer. What would you say Mario is?
An Italian plumber.
But like in a terms platformer? Of the species,
human.
Exactly. In the trailer for Super Mario Odyssey, he goes to like a faux New York and is hanging out with other normal-looking humans. With
that this look like you and me. He's what? A weird goblin child running around going, "Oh, hello!" It's like Grand Theft Auto hack with Mario in it.
No, someone's done that now. But no, the Mario in the Grand Theft Auto hack looks more like you would expect Mario in a real world Mario to look.
Yeah.
They've actually done a better job of it.
I need to see this.
My point, rather than just saying what the fuck, is that that doesn't instill any confidence. Like, that's taking Mario, like, their one benchmark franchise, which they've done really well with of late.
Yeah.
Making solid game after solid game and critical praise after critical praise. And they're going real fuck with that. They're not just going to deliver a Mario game. They're going to do an experimental Mario game when all they've got, really, of the only games that I can see that people play is Zelda and Splatoon.
And I'd get Mario Kart.
Oh yeah, of course. There's Mario. Is that due early?
Mid. Yeah.
But no, it's thing, a remake like, it of is Mario Kart 8, yeah. which I already
Mario
have.
Mario is Mario Kart 8. Splatoon 2.
I didn't know were here. So
Splatoon 2 is. It looks very, very similar to Splatoon as well. These games are games that and Zelda is available on the Wii U at launch. So those are three of its biggest shots that I've barely touched on my Wii U. I can spend hours playing them on that. It's a little bit scary. They need a Wii Sports. They need a party game. They need a Nintendo Land even, yeah. right? Because yeah. Nintendo Land didn't quite do the job on the Wii U, but
it was great.
It's an excellent, excellent little mini game compilation.
Yeah,
they need a WarioWare. That's what they need. It would be perfect. That's like four people's like little things. Hanging out in pairs around a collection of switches.
You're on board. Okay. Anyway, we are, I think, running out of time. But I think I kind of like to end on a semi-positive note after this like railing of Nintendo for mishandling the Switch. There's definitely the possibility that it could really win us back, I think. And at this point, what Nintendo's been offering after that announcement has not been what we want to see. But the premise of the console is such a solid idea that, I mean, it's excited me about a Nintendo console. And I haven't owned a Nintendo console since the GameCube. And I bought the GameCube once it cost me 40 quid because they weren't being made anymore. And I fancied playing some of those. I've never been like a Nintendo acolyte. Yeah. But this seems like a good place for me to jump in. Now, of course, the price is too high and they don't have the lineup. But They have a little bit of time to get things in order. And I think Nintendo has a craft for making games that are so pure and joyful, like so focused on making sure that the second-to-second feel of them is so special and so distinctly Nintendo that they could do that. They could well do that.
So Sega are back on board, and I think it was their Nintendo Working Arm Amusement Vision, right? It had a lot to do with the F-Zero game on the Cube.
Yeah.
If they do that, if they come out and say we're making the new F-Zero, and it launches this summer, I'm in. Like without any shadow of a doubt. Yeah, yeah. Like
it's not Wipeout though. Anyway, that was episode 43 of Taste of My Game Face. I was Azizi Adeyemo.
I'm still Wayne James.
I'm also still Alan Heath.
And I don't know who I am anymore. No, I am Joe Knight.
I'm probably still going to be Azizi Adeyemo after this as well, but who knows? Who knows?
We live in strange times.
Strange and dangerous times. Interesting times, I think, might be the phrase.
Stranger danger.
All right, bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.